So look at Anthony Ryder from South Lyon, Michigan, recently selected as the Lions 2020 Fan of the Year. He has a passion about sports broadcasting.
With the 112th selection in the 2021 NFL Draft, the Detroit Lions select Amon-Ra St. Brown, wide receiver, USC. One prize, baby! What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another Detroit Lions video. Now, the Detroit Lions battled the Denver Broncos on Sunday to keep their playoff hopes alive, to improve in the win column, and to get another victory on the season. And unfortunately, that did not happen. Now, in today's video, we are going to go over everything from stat updates to players of the week and much more. However, before we get into it, let's first get to the scoreboard. Now, the Detroit Lions unfortunately dropped their 11th game of the season to the Denver Broncos, losing this contest by a score of 38-10. The Denver Broncos got off to an incredibly explosive start, scoring touchdowns on their first two offensive possessions, taking a 14-0 lead as the first quarter expired. And just when things were looking really bad for the Detroit Lions, they rallied in the second quarter. They put up 10 unanswered points and finished the half and went into halftime only trailing by 7 points by a score of 17-10. However, unfortunately for the Detroit Lions, that is where their momentum would end, as the Denver Broncos in the second half then proceeded to put up 21 unanswered points, finishing the game with a four-score victory over the Detroit Lions by a score of 34-10. The Denver Broncos advanced on their season to 7-6, keeping their wild card and playoff hopes alive, whereas the Detroit Lions again dropped their 11th contest of the season, officially falling out of playoff chances, officially eliminating them mathematically from the NFL playoffs this season. They are now strictly playing spoiler and strictly evaluating this roster for next year's upcoming season. The Detroit Lions fall to 1-11-1 on the season. Now over to the stat sheet. All around, this game was not a good game for any player in particular. There were very few standout players in this game, and Jared Goff, the starting quarterback, was not one of them. Jared Goff completed 24 of his 39 pass attempts for 215 yards, passing for one touchdown, one interception, and being sacked twice on the day. It was just kind of an average day for Jared Goff. He didn't really put up a lot of numbers on the stat sheet, looked good at times, looked really bad at others. He missed a lot of deep throws down the field, which was really unfortunate to see. You know, there were three deep shots throughout the game where if Jared Goff had hit any of those throws, they would have been massive plays to move the chains, if not touchdown plays. All three of them had the potential to go for touchdowns, but at the very least, if Jared Goff is on the mark for those three passes, it's probably a combined 75 yards and a potential of being three touchdowns on the board. Not to mention the two turnovers in today's game, the fumble by Godwin Igbuoke, and of course the interception thrown by Jared Goff was kind of, it's not the major reason the Detroit Lions lost yesterday, but you consider the fact that Jared Goff missed those three potential touchdown passes plus the two turnovers. That is, I mean, a five possession game right there, three scores and two turnovers, where that can flip the game completely on its head. Now, the rushing attack was a little bit more promising on the day, as Josh Reynolds, the practice squad call-up and the player that was getting his first real opportunity in the NFL, absolutely shined. He averaged 7.5 yards per carry on 11 attempts, and of course, he carried the ball 11 times for the Detroit Lions on Sunday, totaling 85 rushing yards, had three receptions for 52 receiving yards, and all around was the Detroit Lions' biggest and most effective offensive weapon. Now, in my opinion, he did not get as many carries as he should have. Part of that was the Detroit Lions trailing. Part of that was they wanted to get kind of an even split between him and Igbuoke, even though Craig Reynolds was a significantly better running back yesterday, but Craig Reynolds was one of the lone bright spots of this team and was one of the lone bright spots of the rushing attack yesterday. Now you look at the wide receivers, Amon-Ra St. Brown led all wide receivers yesterday with 8 receptions for 73 yards on the day. He had a really good day, lined up in a multitude of positions. He lined up at running back, lined up in the slot, lined up on the boundary. He was kind of utilized everywhere, had 11 targets on the day. Some of them were catchable, some of them were not. On those 11 targets, he had 8 receptions and again totaled 73 yards on the game. Josh Reynolds averaged 17.3 yards per reception on 3 attempts. He had 3 receptions for 52 yards, had the highest yards per catch on the team yesterday, again at 17.3 yards per reception. And Khalif Raymond was the only wide receiver and the only player for the Detroit Lions yesterday to score a touchdown. He had very minimal touches, but again, he did have that touchdown early in the second quarter, which kind of put the Lions back in the game at that point in time. Now, moving over to the defense went into this game heavily injured. They did not have a lot of starters going into it, and unfortunately early in the first quarter they lost 2 more starters as Jerry Jacobs left the game with a pretty serious looking injury, and Alex Anzalone left the game not long after that with an injury that didn't seem as severe as the one suffered by Jerry Jacobs, but an injury that kept him out of the remainder of the game nonetheless. Unfortunately, the injury bug has really been biting the Lions hard this year. They just can't seem to get away from injury and illness, and at every single corner there seems to be something else being detrimental to the Detroit Lions' success this season. But looking at the actual stats, Josh Woods led the team in tackles yesterday with 13 tackles and 2 tackles for loss. Aleem McNeil and Charles Harris both combined for a tackle for loss of their own, and Aleem McNeil actually recorded his first ever NFL and first career sack as a Detroit Lions nose tackle, which was pretty cool to see. I thought Aleem McNeil had a really good day. Josh Woods, for his first ever NFL start being an undrafted rookie free agent, really showed out again, had 13 tackles, 2 tackles for loss, and was one of the lone bright spots on the Detroit Lions defense yesterday. They couldn't stop the run very well. Overall, it was not a great defensive performance, but if you're going to look at one guy and say that guy played well, that guy, you know, stepped up to the plate on Sunday and helped the Detroit Lions to the little success that they had, I would say that Josh Woods was that guy. And then, of course, for special teams, Riley Patterson was perfect yet again, hitting 1 extra point and 1 field goal on both of his attempts. Only had 2 kicks, but he made both, and you can't ask for more out of your kicker. Jack Fox had 3 punts, averaging 53 yards per punt. Again, just being one of the best punters in the NFL as far as yards per punt, net yardage, and stuff like that. I mean, Jack Fox didn't get a ton of opportunity yesterday, only had 3 punts, but averaged 53 yards a punt and did give the Lions some pretty solid field position when he was punting the football. Now, getting into game balls of the week, I have 3 game balls that I wanted to give out today. One for the offensive player of the week, one for the defensive player of the week, and one for the coach of the week. Now, starting with the offensive player that I thought had the best performance against the Denver Broncos, it's going to be Craig Reynolds, a player that was pulled up from the practice squad just a few days before the actual game was played, a player that was thrown into the starting role after having a really solid preseason for the Detroit Lions, rushing very well against the Buffalo Bills and having a couple other impressive runs versus the Steelers and the Colts. A guy that really impressed in the preseason, earned his spot on the practice squad, and bided his time until he got his opportunity, and boy did he take advantage of that opportunity. Craig Reynolds averaged 7.5 yards per carry against the Denver Broncos on 11 carries, totaling out for 85 yards. Now, Craig Reynolds was not utilized very well in the second half. I believe only had 3 carries in the second half alone, and that, for a guy that's averaging 7.5 yards per carry, is not enough. If your running back is going to be that efficient, you have to give him the ball 15, 20, maybe even 25 times a game for him to truly help your football team win. I don't think the Detroit Lions quite realized what they had in Craig Reynolds. I think they went into that game kind of thinking, okay, we don't have our number one, we don't have our number two, we don't even really have our number three in Jamar Jefferson because he is suffering from that illness and isn't 100% right now. So we're going to split carries. We're going to, you know, obviously give Craig Reynolds some carries. We're going to give Godwin Igwebuke some carries, and we're going to kind of split them evenly. I don't think they realized how good Craig Reynolds was going to be on the ground for them. And I think going into this week, they need to game plan more around Craig Reynolds, especially if DeAndre Swift can't return, especially if Jamal Williams can't return, especially if Jamar Jefferson isn't feeling well and is still suffering from the flu, still suffering from that illness. I think you need to lean on the run game a little bit more. When you watch the Lions have success this year, it is through the run game. It's DeAndre Swift gashing for 100-yard games. It's Jamal Williams running through the hole and running over people, keeping the offense on schedule. You know, even the touchdown drive that the Lions had against Denver was set up by a really big run by Craig Reynolds and a couple other solid runs by Godwin Igwabuke. I think that Craig Reynolds was the offensive player of the week. He had 85 rushing yards. He had 52 receiving yards for his first ever NFL start. Before that, he had 2 carries for 7 yards. And in this game, he had 14 touches for 135 yards. Like, I mean, Craig Reynolds showed up in a big moment. He waited for his time, got his opportunity, and took the absolute biggest advantage of it. And I think hearing more playing time going into the game against Arizona. And then my defensive game ball, we've talked about him already, goes to undrafted linebacker Josh Woods. Now, Josh Woods is a player that, again, was elevated from the practice squad this week, a guy that didn't really show it in the preseason in the same way that Craig Reynolds did, but has obviously been showing a lot at practice. It obviously impressed the coaches enough to be one of the 7 practice squad players elevated for this game in Denver. And again, just like Craig Reynolds, Josh Woods took full advantage of the opportunity that he was given. In his first start of his career, he totaled 13 tackles, 2 tackles for loss, and a quarterback hit, and was one of the few lone bright spots of the Detroit Lions defense against Denver. Now, I know as a team, as a unit, and as a defense as a whole, the Lions didn't play their best game. The Lions allowed over 28 rushing attempts for 185 yards and 3 touchdowns. It was not a good day on the ground for the Detroit Lions. However, I thought Josh Woods was pretty impressive. I thought he tackled well. I thought he had pretty good speed, pretty good instincts, wasn't a liability in coverage either. Although he didn't have a pass defended, he was in some good situations in pass defense. And overall, I thought Josh Woods, for an undrafted free agent, a guy that wasn't expected to even play this season, let alone start a game for the Detroit Lions, for him to go out there and have that kind of a performance, just like Craig Reynolds, I think that if Alex Anzalone can't start next week, if that injury is still bugging him, another player that was added to the injury list this week, I think Josh Woods alongside Derek Barnes could be a pretty solid rotation, or could be a pretty solid linebacking duo, considering that, again, our starting linebacker is out and Jalen Reeves-Maybin is out. I think that Josh Woods could step in and be a really good kind of depth linebacker piece for the Detroit Lions while they try to get healthy, while they try to bring back Jalen Reeves-Maybin, while they try to bring back Alex Anzalone. If some of those guys can't play for another week or two, I think that Josh Woods can step up, and I think that he can have another repeat performance of what he did versus Denver, and hopefully the team around him steps up to the plate in a similar manner to what he did in week 14. Now, my third and final game ball for this week is for the coach of the week. And I know a lot of people might look at this game and say, okay, you lost by 4 possessions. You lost 38-10. What could there possibly be a coach to deserve a game ball? But in my opinion, I thought Dan Campbell called a very good game. I thought Dan Campbell as a play caller over the past 3 weeks has grown tremendously. He's went from calling draw plays and screen plays on third and long to calling deep shots down the field to converting those third and longs. I know there was like a third and I believe it was 20 or third and 15 that, you know, they had Jared Goff step back. He passed a really good, really pretty ball over the linebacker and before the cornerback right to Josh Reynolds and did not quite pick up the first down, but got close enough to the point where they could go for it on fourth down, and they eventually converted and drove down the field. They didn't score on that drive, as unfortunately I believe they did turn it over on downs, or that was the drive that Jared Goff threw the interception. But regardless, you know, you go from running screen passes and you go from running draw plays on third and long to running a play that was pretty successful. Got you, I believe, 17 yards on the play, 18 yards on the play, got you within 1 yard of that first down, and gave you the opportunity to go for it on fourth down. You know, I mentioned earlier about the 3 shot plays that Jared Goff just wasn't quite able to hit yesterday. There was the 1 double move to Khalif Raymond where he was down on the boundary, gone on the sidelines, had a step on the cornerback, and if Jared Goff places it at maybe the 3-yard line on the sideline, pretty close to the sideline, or maybe even on the pylon, Cleve Raymond is walking in for a touchdown, but instead, Jared Goff placed that ball a little too far outside and it landed incomplete out of bounds. There was the play on third and long to number 84 where he had a step on the linebacker or the safety, and Jared Goff just slightly overthrew it. It wasn't a bad play call. It was actually a really good play design that got a big body tight end open on the sideline, and there was nobody between him and the end zone. If Jared Goff leads him upfield just a little bit and is able to complete that pass, at the very least, it's a 20-yard gain, and at the most, it's a 40-yard touchdown pass for Jared Goff on the day. And then you look at the second-to-last drive of the game, and then you go to the final drive of the game where, yeah, the game is over. Maybe the Denver Broncos aren't trying as hard, but, you dial up a really deep shot play to Khalil Hodge, and Khalil Hodge had a step, his defender tripped, and unfortunately Jared Goff yet again just wasn't able to connect with his wide receiver down the field. That's not on Dan Campbell. Dan Campbell, in my opinion, called a really good game. Dan Campbell put his team in a position to win. He called the plays that needed to be called in order to win that football game. Unfortunately for him, his team let him down. His team did not execute. Jared Goff didn't make the passes. Godwin Igwabuke fumbled twice. Jared Goff threw that interception. None of those turnovers are on Dan Campbell. Dan Campbell called the right plays. His players just weren't quite able to execute as well, right? You look at the turnover on downs when the Lions had the ball at the 1 yard line. He called a run play to a player that was averaging 7.5 yards a carry, and Jared Goff happened to get stepped on by his center and fall and was eventually sacked on that play. That's not on Dan Campbell. I thought Dan Campbell called a tremendous game. I thought Dan Campbell as a play caller, especially going from last week to this week, improved a lot in just 7 days. And I'm excited to see where Dan Campbell continues to go from here. I think he's going to continue to call plays. He's going to continue to get more and more aggressive with this offense. And I really think that with Dan Campbell growing as a play caller, this offense can continue to grow, develop, and continue to get better over the final 5 weeks of this NFL season. Now, moving on to the story of the week. It's the story that we talked about over the entire live stream. It's the story that all Lions fans talked about all week, and that was the injury bug yet again biting the Detroit Lions. The Detroit Lions went into this week with a fairly healthy roster, right? They finished the Minnesota game without any major injury, and everybody thought, okay, going into Denver with some momentum, with a fairly healthy roster, with some confidence. And then the injury report came out on Monday, and that injury report held 23 different players. That is nearly 20% of the Detroit Lions roster that was not fully healthy for this game. Now, the injury list included players like Jared Goff, DeAndre Swift, TJ Hockenson, Penei Sewell, Taylor Decker, Charles Harris, Michael Brockers, Levi Onwuzurike, just to name a few. And that is not even including players like Julian Okwara, who is one of our better pass rushers, doesn't even include the COVID list that added three more names to it over the week, including starting running back Jamal Williams, starting safety in Tracy Walker, and former third round selection, and a player that a lot of people are incredibly high on in Ifeatu Melifonwu. With all the injuries going into the game, even a majority of players that did play in the game, players like Penei Sewell, players like Taylor Decker, players like Jared Goff and Charles Harris, weren't 100% playing in that game, and the Lions were already without 20% of their roster when they kicked off for that game. It didn't help that their starting cornerback Jerry Jacobs got injured on the third play of the game, and their starting linebacker and leader of the defense in Alex Anzalone got hurt just a few drives later. So, the Lions, you look at their injuries, you look at all the adversity that they faced this week, and it's kind of hard to imagine them winning this game, right? You go into a game without nearly 20% of your roster, you go into a week where your starting quarterback is sick, pretty much your whole starting offensive line is sick, your starting running back is out with a shoulder injury, your biggest receiving weapon's out with a hand injury, defensively, you lose your starting safety, you lose a really promising young cornerback. Again, back on the offensive side, you lose kind of the heart and soul of your offense. You lose the heart of your team in Jamal Williams to the COVID list. The Lions did the best they could with what they had. They didn't have a lot of talent going into that game. They didn't have a lot of talent to put on the field. They played eight different players that were undrafted rookie free agents or undrafted free agents going into their second year, and elevated 7 more players from the practice squad just to field enough players to compete in this game. The Lions were at an extreme talent deficit for a majority of the game, and for the first half, they didn't look outmatched and they didn't really look outclassed. I mean, they went into halftime down just 7 points, losing the game 17-10 and getting the ball back when they came back from halftime. And unfortunately, coming back from halftime, the fumble happened and then the interception happened, and they gave the Denver Broncos a short field on 2 or 3 drives in a row, and that unfortunately did seal the fate for the Detroit Lions. But you look at this game and you look at the talent that the Detroit Lions were fielding. They fielded 8 undrafted players to start in that game on both the offensive and defensive side, and then they elevated 7 more players from the practice squad that either started or had really key roles in the offense and defense yesterday. So you look at this team, you look at the roster that took the field talent-wise, it was probably the worst NFL roster to hit the field maybe ever. I mean, I don't know another team that's fielded that many undrafted free agents, a team that fielded that many practice squad players in 1 week and relied on that talent, if you could even call it that, to elevate them to a victory over a now 7-6 Denver Broncos team who was vying for the playoffs, who has gone toe-to-toe with Baltimore and Kansas City and LA and other teams like that. Denver's been tested. Denver has put in some work. They were 500 going into the game. Now they're above 500 right in the wild card race after that game. And they played a Detroit Lions team that was battered and bruised and really suffered from the injury bug more than anybody else this week. So with that being said, the Lions did the best that they could with the talent that they were given. And at the end of the day, the outcome isn't really all that surprising. But with all that being said, that is all I have for you guys today. That is all the Lions news that we have for right now. Make sure you tune in tomorrow for some more Lions content. But until then, that is all I have for you guys today. Thank you all so very much for watching. And until next time, and as always, go Lions!